There were times when to learn a skill, you had no other option than school. Decades later, it became possible to learn not through books anymore, but on the internet. And so it began, platforms flourishing one after the other. But today, there's an even more powerful way to learn, and that is not learning at all. The best example of this is a car. Most of us don't know what's behind the engine, yet we use it as a tool to move faster. What if the same thing existed for a React Native? What if instead of spending months learning it, there was a shortcut, a great way of making an app? Recently, I had the chance to talk with two folks at DraftBit, a company that simplifies the entire process of creating mobile applications using React Native.
DraftBit, you know, I think like in a sentence, you could say DraftBit is the Webflow for apps. We're an app builder for people that don't necessarily know how to build apps.
Today, I want to tell you their story through the eyes of its makers. So sit back and enjoy.
My name is Donald Horuska. I'm one of the co-founders and the VP of engineering of DraftBit. We've been working on it for around 3 years now, but working as a company for a little under four. We were working on a previous startup idea before we pivoted the business over to DraftBit, which happy to talk more about if you're interested. I spend a lot of my time writing code because we're still a pretty small team trying to build a pretty big product.
So I'm Jordan. I'm originally a software engineer. So I've studying software engineering and I worked as a software engineer for about 10 years, mostly with smaller tech startups. One of them got acquired at eBay. So I spent 4 years at eBay, which is the opposite of a small tech startup, a giant multinational. About 5 years ago, I switched to product management. So since then, I kind of went back to smaller tech environments, smaller startups, but as a product manager, as a PM. And most recently, I joined DraftBit, where I'm the director of product management. That's currently what I do.
Before that, I was, you know, at a couple different web development agencies working on web apps and, websites for sort of like a whole variety of types of companies. And then, I got kind of tired of that. I decided I would rather build stuff like for the company that I work for. You know, I want to work on like a product team, building something for ourselves or building something for internal stakeholders.
Even if DraftBit has been around for a few years now, it actually took them a long time to think of creating this platform.
We started working together in 2017, myself and my co-founders, Peter and Brian. We were working on this mobile app. We had a variety of users and we applied to Y Combinator, the startup accelerator. We went through the program with Orchard at the time, and we were coming back every week to the dinners at YC, and our batchmates were, using Orchard, and they were telling us, for a variety of different reasons, it wasn't really working for them. But, we seemed really passionate about mobile apps and about React Native and about just technology in general. And so, they told us, hey, you guys should think about that and, see what you can come up with. And so we came back to Chicago in early 2018 and we, kind of went back to the drawing board and decided that, maybe building that app wasn't gonna work out, but maybe we could design a way for anyone to be able to build their own mobile app. And so we started working on DraftBit.
And then it was really just a matter of meeting the team. I feel like as cheesy as it sounds, for having worked at maybe five or six tech startups now, it comes down to like the team and like if you enjoy the people you're working with and if they're like bright and you know that they will be able to like go through the challenges and the roller coaster of what a startup is, that is a very good sign. And I really enjoy the team and it's going very well. So that's the main reason I joined.
We've been really intentional about how we built the team. And I think, at this point we're less than a dozen people and we built this team of people that I think really, really cares about the mission, really cares about the space that we're in. And, I think that is something great. I've worked at places where people are just coming into their day job doing the work, and I think it's definitely not like that here, so that definitely I think makes a huge impact. And the funniest thing for me I think is even with COVID, like now we've started hiring people wherever, all over the US or even now in Europe we have some people. So like just the ability to work with these people from all over the world that half of whom I've never even met in person, you know, that's pretty crazy to me.
There's always a little bit of a risk to join for the product. What if the product is very different a year from now? What if the market is very different? What if the audience is very different? Will you still be able to work there and be excited? So focusing on the people and a few other assets you have at the company might be another way to like think a little bit longer term for that relationship.
Speaking of which, the team at DraftBit has been evolving through the years. As with every startup, it usually begins with a small group of people before getting bigger and more established.
We have three co-founders, Brian, who is our CEO, and he's, you know, he knows code, he knows all that. He's a little bit more product and business kind of, that's a little bit more of his background. Peter and Donald are the other two co-founders. They're just software engineers, like hardcore, very talented software engineers. We have customer support, head of growth, COO, like all those like function that kind of helps me and help the team create the right product. But it's a lot of it is just engineering.
An interesting question you might have at this point is, what's so special about DraftBit?
One of the key differentiators of DraftBit is that you can export your code. So every time you do something, you can not only see the code, you can export it, your whole project. You're not locked in DraftBit. You can, you know, stop using us. So to your point, like some people do use it just to like make a screen visually, and then they export that code, they import in their own thing. And we're fine with that. We really are. Like that's part of what we believe in. So we care a lot about like code quality and things like exportability and all that.
You know, if you decide, hey, this isn't for me, you know, I'd rather go on my own, you don't have to totally start over. You know, we write the tool outputs code that is as good as code that I would write, which is sort of how we look at things.
At a higher level, I really like to be working on a product, and DraftBit is not the only one, there are others like that, where you're essentially empowering a new demographics. You're empowering new people, like you give them the tools that maybe you and I had being like on the software engineering side of things, but people who don't know how to code, all of a sudden you give them this, them access to like, oh, you can make an app, you can start your business online, you can do all the things. If you think of YouTube and things like that, like really democratized access to like video making. So like just applying that same thought process to app development. And what if it's not just software engineer building app? What if it's not just business folks or finance folks or, you know, once we get to that point, I think it'll be interesting. And it could be DraftBit, it could be something else, like, but like something, there will be a way, or at least that's the assumption we're making, there will be a way in the next few years for everybody to have access to that. And so who's going to make that a reality? I think that's a pretty exciting thing to work on.
I think for me, the idea of being able to contribute to the world in such a way that more people are able to write software, whether that means that they were able to build software using our platform, or even just that, you know, the work we're doing in a way helps someone understand a little bit more how to code. You know, that's what keeps me going, really. I think, you know, like you said earlier, you know, the ability to enable more and more people to create their idea and maybe build their business, I think is amazing, right? Like to have the privilege of knowing how to write software is something that only a small amount of people in the world, you know, in the grand scheme of things, are able to do. And so anything that we can do to give more people the tools to, you know, either put their ideas into action or to further themselves in their careers, I think is great work. And so that's, you know, that's really, I think, more than anything, what kind of keeps me going.
Besides being extremely motivated and caring a lot about their vision, DraftBit took a very wild bet 4 years ago, using React Native and Expo, and make it the core of the engine they were building for the platform.
You know, I mean, I think first of all, I think React Native is amazing. I think, you know, we've obviously made a big bet on it, you know, sort of like, you know, making it the output of our product. And Expo also specifically, you know, Expo is an amazing company building an amazing product. And I think, you know, they enable us to do a lot of the things that we do. So we love React Native and we love Expo for sure. As far as like the advantages, you know, I think obviously the cross-platform iOS and Android single code base that runs anywhere. I think a lot of times I talk to people and they're like, you know, well, it doesn't really work like that, right? Like, you have to, like, don't you actually have to write the code twice? And my answer is, like, unless you're trying to do something crazy, you know, no, you don't. You really don't. And you know, now with a lot of the great work that Expo is doing, it works on the web too. So, you know, iOS, Android, and a PWA, all with a single code base. That's a huge competitive advantage. And so I'm, you know, super happy that we've placed that bet. As far as open source, you know, I think we definitely value open source. I think, you know, our component library that runs inside of DraftBit that we call Jigsaw, we've open sourced that. So
we try to give back as much as we can. Not even like almost not an effort. It's a little bit in our DNA. Like, I think compared to other companies, we're very like engineering driven.
Part of, like, you know, the way that we think about things as developers is that we don't want, you know, we wouldn't personally use a product that locks us into some arbitrary ecosystem that, you know, we're stuck paying a monthly fee to if we don't want to. So, you know, the output of our tool is all, it's all, you know, yours. It uses our DraftBit UI Jigsaw library for UI components, but that's all open source. So, you know, that's all out there in the world, and the, you know, the community is contributing to that, which is great.
When I learned about the platform, one thing I couldn't help myself thinking about was the amount of work they must have been through. It took years for website builders like Webflow or Wix to become more mainstream, and there's still a long way before we get the same level for mobile application builders.
The whole like no-code movement and like cohort of companies is going through that thing where like it is going to take, I don't know, like a couple of years before those tools are really have the potential to go a bit more mainstream. And that, so right now when you're in that industry, you know, it looks like a ton of stuff are happening and ton of stuff are happening indeed. But you know, if you take a step back and you look from the rest of the world, like this is still not something that's mainstream. Like,
right? Webflow has been around for, you know, quite a while now. They were well known at that point. But they're, you know, obviously more website driven. I think there was like some stuff in like more the developer space. There's been Ionic. They've been around for quite a while, and some other tools like that. But you know, a lot of the other kind of no code app builders, I think, are relatively recent in the last couple of years, similar to us.
So as an industry, I think it's going to take a couple of years for that to be a little bit more mainstream. And so until then, it's a matter of like, there are many other subset of audiences that we can help along the way. So like for us right now, like digital agencies, like if you're an agency and you do like web stuff and you want to add like mobile development to your, you know, skill set, this is a perfect opportunity. And now is actually a good time for you to like get on board, because like you're going to have an edge. It's still early on, but you can really benefit from that. Your ROI is going to be good from a business point of view. So like, you know, it's a matter of, it's going to be about like jumping from different audience to audience until we get to that mainstream one.
In the way that Webflow has built this whole kind of ecosystem of like freelancers and those types of people, you know, people that maybe historically didn't know how to code or sort of like maybe knew only a little bit how to code, Webflow is this amazing tool that's given them the ability to now build websites for people, right? And it still allows them to jump in and write HTML or export and understand the HTML. And I think we really admire that. And I think we want to kind of do the same thing, but for mobile. So given people that, you know, maybe now have been able to sort of create a business on top of Webflow, we want to be a tool that we can go to those people and say, hey, you know, you're building websites for clients. You can build mobile apps for clients now too. And you don't have to touch the code if you don't want to, but if you do want to, or if you want to try to understand, you know, we give you the tools for that. I don't have to learn Objective-C and Java to build my iOS and Android app, or I don't have to, you know, learn how to use React Native. I can just like build this visual tool. And if I want to drop some stuff in or integrate with my own backend, like I can kind of figure it out because I already sort of get the basics.
Now, I think like I mentioned, the persona for which I think it makes a lot of sense right now is those agencies. I think they're willing to like invest a little bit of time up front. Then you're going to kind of benefit from that for 5, 10, 15 clients over the next year. So for those guys, I would say it's definitely ready, or at least it's definitely a good time to like get started.
We got somebody that's building a fintech startup on the platform. I think they are familiar with code, but not a lot of experience with mobile. We had a doctor that built a sort of like side startup idea on the platform. And I don't know the specifics, but I know that he built that with Airtable as a backend, which I think is something that we're seeing people do because they've got a really amazing API, you know, the whole wide variety of stuff.
Beyond even DraftBit, I think there is this idea that it's because it's going to take a couple of months or years before those tools are really addressing all the potential use case. Everything you might want to do in a web app, like you'll be on a mobile app, you'll be able to do. Until we catch up to all those use cases, we don't want you to be stuck and be like, well, I tried DraftBit, but I cannot import my camera or anything, so I left. So we do let you inject code. So not only you can export code, but you can also like inject code and write your custom code and do everything you might want to do, like from payments to, you know, GPS and things like that. So the idea there that we don't want you to be limited.
I mean, the advantage of custom code is that, like, if you're willing to get your hands dirty, you can really build anything, right? Because anything that you could do by hand, you can do in the platform now. So I think that's something that works to our advantage. Within the platform, you can do quite a bit. You know, you can build out screens to a pretty granular level. We have some theming built in. So it's, you know, the ability to add fonts and colors and bring in your, you know, your brand. If for example, you're an agency working for a client, that's all there. You know, navigating between screens, passing data around, fetching data from an API, sending data back to that API, that's all there. We're launching Firebase support soon. So that was one of our most requested features. So we're going to start with Firestore and authentication. That's going to be sort of the first frontier. We have a public roadmap at roadmap.draftbit.com that sort of has all the things that people are requesting and we're thinking about. So that's a resource that we spend a lot of time on. And yeah, you know, I think this week we've been working on some of the more enhanced custom code stuff. So that's something I've been, you know, spending a lot of time thinking about, just like trying to figure out how to do things by hand. And then I think we'll have some kind of like snippet library for people to be able to just like grab chunks of code and paste it in and get things working, just sort of, you know, as a way to provide integrations with whatever, while we figure out how to build the more, you know, polished UI over the next, you know, weeks and months for some of the things that we're still missing. I think we're making progress, and I think we've got a long way to go. You know, I think, you know, like I said earlier, to be able to build a product that other people use to build their products, there's so much involved in that, right? Like I said, I think we've got a ways to go, but I think it's definitely starting to feel like we're on the right path. If you're someone who is thinking about building something and you don't have the technical, or you don't think you have the technical knowledge to do it, I think there's a lot of tools out there to help you build the thing that you're thinking about, whether it's ours or it's someone else's. You know, there's a lot of amazing tools, and there's more of them getting built every year. And so, you know, give it a try. I think like we would love to help you build the thing that you're trying to build. Don't be afraid to try, and don't be afraid to reach out. I think we're always looking to talk to people, and we want to help people achieve their goals. So, you know, please give us a try, send us a message, and give it a go.
All right. I know this was a long one, and I hope you enjoyed it as much as I enjoyed making it. I can't thank George and Donald enough, whom both made this possible. DraftBit really keeps evolving and has already a lot to offer. So give it a try. It's free. Remember to subscribe if you want more React Native videos like this one. Thanks for watching, and see you next time.